We're going live in 3, 2, 1. Vaedrin, take it away.
Hello and welcome to Station 42, your weekly content and community-focused Star Citizen talk show. Today's show is hosted by the one and only Basics. Say hello, Basics.
Hey, everyone, how's it going?
Hello and welcome. And yours truly, the infamously smooth Vaedrin Mallack.
Tonight's Station 42 broadcast supports the global Star Citizen community.
Our partners include the Star Citizen Facebook group, known as Ready Player One, largest in the verse. And if you're looking for brilliant in-fiction lore with audiobook-quality sound production, stop by sclorecast.com and check out Workbane's MVP work.
Lastly, if you're a newer veteran pilot, swing by the community voice comms and flight hub over at discord.me/StarCitizenRP1. The link's in on the Facebook page. An absolute great way to interact with the community while representing your org. Or just relaxing as a free agent. Details, all of the above, can be linked in our show notes.
So, we have a wonderful guest, pillar of the community, Mr. Erris. Erris, he's coming all the way from Canada. Very healthy fleet of ships. Erris is currently flying for INN's in-game org, obviously. So, Erris, great to have you with us tonight.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, so tell us a bit. So we know the bit's going on. So are you thinking about changing orgs? You going freelance now? Or so what's your plan with orgs going?
With respect to orgs, I've never really put too much into the orgs, especially as we're kind of waiting for, you know, orgs to kind of come online a bit more. There's going to be a new org at wherever we end up, but I'm not going to say what that is yet, so... But yeah, we'll run a news org out of that. But nope, can't say it. My lips are sealed. Sorry.
Oh, this is gonna be so. I'm gonna try. I just want to point this out right now. I'm gonna try this entire night to get you to say something. Something. Just something.
The 24-hour piracy pirate channel.
Pirate channel.
Yeah, 24-hour pirate. The 24-hour pirate channel. All pirates.
We are the
time.
Exact opposite of pirates. So we give things freely to everyone. I'm not a pirate. I'm not good enough flying to be a pirate.
Star Citizen Anonymous.
We give bullets. I mean, come on. We do give. I mean, come on.
So I gotta ask, whose idea was the idea to form an org, you know, news channel in verse? That's I haven't thought about it. I mean, obviously there's a ship now dedicated towards it, which is pretty, or a variant of a ship. Let me you know, be specific here. But you know, so do you guys like hoping that there'll be an inverse channel maybe that you can broadcast on and keep us all abreast in the latest news, or you can submit news, or what are your thoughts into it, and whose idea was it?
Whose idea it was, honestly, is kind of lost at this point. When we started, we were just like, when INN, which I was before, started, we were just like CIG news. And then over the course of running that, we got so many people, you know, asking us if we were going to continue into inverse news as well, that it just kind of snowballed into a, yeah, we will. We're going to find a way to run an inverse news as well. I mean, we're hoping that, because CIG have actually talked about some of the features that they want to put into the Reliant Mako when it comes to allowing people to, you know, do in pictures and streaming from the ship. And we're like, well, yeah, why not have an inverse news org that we can, like, we can fly along beside Operation Pitchfork and broadcast what's happening in Operation Pitchfork live to the rest of the verse and write it up and have it both in verse news, and we can have articles and video and stuff on the website as well. And so, yeah.
Like embedded war reporters kind of thing.
Basically, yeah.
kind of a spooky thing, though. I hope to goodness that... I mean, that's going to be like a one-page line. Operation Pitchfork? Yeah, they died. Next.
So Vaedrin, I got a question for a pirate. I need you to put your pirate hats on. So
I already got it on. Let's go.
I noticed. So what if a news guy wanted to come to you as a pirate? They say you got a group where you're working independent or whatever, and then wanted to be like, hey, you know, can I get a life in a day of a pirate? Would you say, if Erris approached you in verse, would you let him tag along and get a documentary on that? Or Erris, would you want to?
there's two answers to that, and it depends on where I'm at. If I am soloist operation, single player, you know, just me and a few friends, that kind of thing, nah, don't trust them. No. If I am trying to, however, if I've got an org or a clan going on, then that becomes a whole different ball of wax, because he's publicity. If I show that I treat my members fairly and I show that I treat everybody on an equal footing, then I'm going to want to say, yeah, come on. We're going to vet you. We're going to make sure here's three or four rails of coke. We need you to do that first. but we're going to basically make sure that, you know, we're going to check you out. But yeah, we would let that happen. So yeah, I would certainly, I don't see where that would be a bad thing. Now, we will alter some of the details, like, you know, hey, this is where we always go to drink at. No, that's not where we always go to drink at. That's not where you can find us at. So yeah, it's information sensitive, but yeah, if he doesn't mind being bound and gagged and hauled around in the back of an Avenger with three rails of coke, then sure, he can
do it. So what do you think, Erris? That's a bit of a...
We've actually already talked about this and considered it. And one of the things that we want to make sure that we can offer to things like pirate orgs or orgs that may want to, you know, stay slightly less in the limelight. I've been considering it, and we'd offer things like a delayed report. So let's say you've got an operation you want to run. We're not going to do live reporting on that operation. We're not going to tip anyone off to what you're doing. We'll delay the report valuable, by a week.
That is a very valuable information, though. And so that's the thing of that's the crux of the matter. See, you would have to be top star vetted from everybody and anybody, and you would want to be the ethical high ground to the supreme. You'd have to have a Snow White reputation to be able to pull that off,
because that's what we plan to do. Because I know it's not something lots of people want to give away, right?
We'll give it away. We're ships, all right here at this time. Everybody go this way. Yeah, don't trust that news.
that's a really good question, actually. So, Erris, what do you think about disinformation campaigns?
I would not participate in one if I knew about it. And if someone decided that they would, you know, trick us into putting out some disinformation, we just wouldn't work with them anymore.
Gotcha. So, go ahead.
Well, I mean, the thing with disinformation is just like this would be just like a mercenary thing. This would be just like a piracy thing, a military thing. It's not even a premise. It's like, yeah, sure, we could say where we're at, but that's not really where we're at. And we can tell you that, yeah, this is honest, legitimate cargo that we've got back here, but it's not honest, legitimate cargo. There's a granular level. If I'm deliberately trying to flat out lie about my operation, it's a completely different ball of wax, as opposed to everything's on the up and up and we just don't need you to know certain details. So where's that gray line? What's that line like? I mean, do I have to say, yes, I'm on this planet at this time?
For me, personally, the line would be, you tell me where you are, and then you tell me, I don't want this information released, though, and we would not release that. We're trying to make sure that we can do when we start this in-game news is basically say that, I mean, we will keep, there will be, we're journalists. We will, you know, we will hold our sources. We won't post stuff that we've been, you know, told is confidential, but we have ethical standards, basically is where it's at. And we're going to run with those.
Yeah, that's fantastic. I mean, it's what I was expecting, but it's going to be an interesting thing. This is going to be something happening in the verse, and if you're not the only news group, for instance, there may be a competition even for pirates to put out as much disinformation as possible. Yeah. I have certain plans about that for a legitimate use, even. But one of my favorite parts about this game, and I might go on a short tangent here, very short, but the intrigue that will happen between players and the intrigue that will happen between organizations and individuals like you and organizations like what you're talking about will be where these individuals are getting information from, because that's the grapevine. And I can't wait for that. I can't wait to see all the different SKUs on that. I can't wait to see... Oh, I'm going to get off on that. I'm just going to get back on you. Vaedrin, you want to get us back on subject?
We're hopping right back on it. So, did you guys launch the org simultaneously with the site originally, or how did that go about?
I think originally the org was launched well after the site. I know that the new site, we're going to be launching the org with the site. But for right now, honestly, the org is going to be really, really closed. We're not about open membership because of exactly what I was talking about before. We need to vet our reporters. We need to make sure that they will follow the same, the same journalistic standards that we do. And that's going to take us probably until launch to figure out how to vet people. Because we're going to take that seriously.
So that's a good tie in here. So post launch, after release, we're talking after full Squadron 42 and we're talking full Star Citizen release. How do you see your org operating at that point? Will you be recruiting more members, or do you think you'll already have everyone that you want, or you're already going to start making missions, or, were you thinking about even maybe getting a little involved in the conflicts, maybe taking a side over the other, or are you just going to stay pure neutral?
Don't do it. You'll wind up like Fox or something. Don't do that.
I think we will try to stay very, very neutral. We're going to try and report on what we see both in game development and in the game itself. When it comes to like org structure and stuff, I can see us having like a high level org base, like the people that we would use to send on a journey with a bunch of pirates that don't want anything special divulged. But I'm also trying to think of ways that we can use like newer people to report sort of less important happenings, still things that are like, oh, this planet's being blockaded. Send in a news report and the site reports this planet is currently being blockaded. Stuff like that, right? And like by starting low and working your way up, you could be allowed to access to more important tasks. But we're planning on starting at pretty high level.
That's awesome. I'm even more excited. Man.
All right, so forgive me. What are you most excited for going forward post launch?
Post launch,
oh boy,
that's honestly a difficult one. I think I'm really excited to see the conversation around the game start to change. The conversation to this point has been, it's been a lot about ships. It's been a lot about the promises made, and it's been a lot about why isn't it done yet? Why is it like the, not the Star Citizen fan base conversation, but the rest of gamers population. It's been, oh, I heard about this thing. Why isn't it out yet? That kind of stuff. And I'm excited to start seeing that conversation change and start seeing what people actually have to say about the game itself.
I'm actually looking forward to seeing some of your work, so I'm anticipating that. I'm just hoping that it isn't used for strategic maneuvering, because they can still be completely honest and saying this is our plans going forward, so that they could kind of manipulate. I'm very intrigued by this. So what's your involvement felt like so far in the game, orgs, comms versus duties, that you've had that you've held before?
Again, not really much org work before. We had an org. It was locked. I think we had like 8 members total. My involvement.
We're so big.
Yeah, we were huge. but we're not about you know, large org numbers. We're about news.
Yeah,
and my involvement with the game has been about helping other orgs and other podcasts and other people get all of the information as condensed as possible, so that everyone can find out what the game's about.
Certainly. Very, very nice. Maybe one day, maybe you'll be able to actually write an almanac of what's happened over this year. I think that would be a really intriguing idea. That would just like, this org got into this fight, these groups right here manipulated this right here, and make a nice little history. I'm a big fan of being able to look back and seeing accomplishments, and I want my name stamped in there 30 times somehow. So
the year in review kind of thing?
Basically. Yeah. What it is.
I mean, we've considered doing that kind of thing for the out-of-game news, like the development news already. Doing something like that in-game as well would be, see why we would.
Yes.
It would also be a good cash revenue generator. It's like you can put the ads on the other pages. Like every other one. Hey, look, there's like 30 ads from testing here. Okay.
I like the look. That right there.
I like Test. They're a fun bunch. So Mike Test. Anyway, so I'm gonna go ahead and like pick on the new guy. So Basics, take it away for the anniversary sale.
Oh, well, in general, or okay, so the anniversary sale this year.
We have a script. Come on now.
I know. I was trying to make something funny here. Anyway, it's a big money maker this year. It always is. But the question is, does it stack up against previous years? Any thoughts on the matter between you guys? You think the sales went higher? I'm actually in the process of going on the site because, you know, I'm prepared and not.
It has actually been almost exactly equal to previous years. At the time of writing the anniversary sale has brought in $3.5 million. There's still 4 days remaining. When the 890 jump went on sale, funding actually spiked to $140,000 in an hour.
Yeah, who didn't see that coming? Who didn't see that?
I know Nakara has done more stuff. Nakara, by the way, just knows everything about numbers for this game, but basically, it sounds like right now, if the anniversary sale continues the way it is, especially on the final day, and then there's going to be a holiday sale as well, this could be the best, more like one of the best years in Star Citizen funding.
Which is fantastic.
Would you dare to say the best year, aside from like maybe the first year?
Ah, jeez.
That's... Majoring with the hard questions today.
I'm sorry. I don't have my Traz. I don't have my backup. He's usually like able to rant his ass out of a box and back in it. I'm on the other hand, I'm like, I gotta really pinpoint these.
I know. Hang on. Here it is. I think it's this one. Sorry, I'm looking something up right now. Oh, so, 2012. 7.2 million, 2013, 28.4, 2014, 32.9, 2015, 35.9 million dollars in those years. Now, 8 days ago, before this sale, before the anniversary sale started, it had made 26 million. Now, we're almost at 4 million now from the anniversary sale. So that means it's basically at 30 million. It needs about $5 million to $6 million in the rest of the year to be the best year to date, which, considering the anniversary sale is only halfway done, it's made four, another few days of the anniversary sale, let's say it gets to seven, and then the holiday, I would actually be comfortable saying that this might be the best year in Star Citizen funding.
You heard it here first. You heard it here first.
So basically, I've got a. We'll go ahead and we'll make it a wager. Will you bet a ship skin on it?
I don't think I have any shift skins, but sure, I could pick one up. I'll bet.
I'm teasing. we don't need to get into the money thing too much. We're broke jokes around here. This right here cost me way too much. Well, at least I am. Traz is rich, but he's cool. Sexy animal. It's like the most interesting man in the world's cousin, Traz.
So speaking of ship skins, any thoughts on the the ship skins that came out during the sale?
They look good.
What, me?
Okay.
I don't know who was answering this one.
I want the Titan, that one, and beyond that, I'm just and I'm probably going to trade out. I'm probably going to get rid of my E-War for that one, because I just like the look of it, and I'm so sick and tired. I like the black and white, but come on, guys. The paint job should have been done already.
I think my thing is I don't know how much I like the paint jobs that they put into place. Some of them look all right. I'm more excited about just what they were talking about, how easy it is and how possible it will be for us to do our own ship skins, and for like orgs to use a hex code and just everyone in that org can color their ships the same thing. Like, you think about Test, and they've got, I don't know how many, 14 million Test members or whatever it is, ridiculous that they've got.
Our auroras will blot out the sun. Yeah.
Yeah. All they have to do is create an official Test hex, give that to all their members, and all Test ships can be colored the same. I think that's, I like that personally. Oh,
yeah. I'm hoping that there's a difference. I'm hoping that the ship skins will be like, we'll have the emblems, we'll have all the little unique, highly detailed resolution kind of artworks that can be had on them. Like, you know, maybe if you might have a flaming ship skin, or you might have an electrocution ship skin, something to that effect. Maybe an ice one with frost lines going down it. I'm hoping that would be a skin, but I'm hoping that the hex code will be something really just a simple color palette swap, so that the people that bought the ship skins would actually have a lot of value for their ship skin, as opposed to being able to actually make it right then and there. Oh, hey, look, I'm black and red, and now I've just stamped on this little pirate emblem right here. I'm good to go. But, you know, hey, I'm really hoping that they give it a little bit more thought than just, you know, letting people go willy-nilly and make all the colors and everything they can do.
So I have a question that's a bit backtracking here, but we were talking about the numbers earlier, and this is a good one. So how do those higher numbers correlate against the increase in total backers, you know, just to get an accurate success measure?
Oh, jeez.
Is that just throwing like a just...
He has to have the population count. He has to have the population count.
He's Mr. Data.
I'm the problem is, I'm actually not Mr. Funding Data. Nakara is. He could give an answer to that. I just know how to repeat his answers that he gives me.
Yes, Traz. No, Traz. Sorry, Traz.
I run the news thing. I don't do anything. I tell everyone under me to do
You're
things.
The polish. You're the polish. Yeah. Polish.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
But I have no idea. I don't know the correlation on that. I'm sorry.
It's a simple metric of population versus count versus the, you know, how much dollars was spent at that time. So in 2015, how, you know, in the year 2015, how many new members did we have versus how much extra dollars did we make? Yeah. And then even then, you're assuming that the other older backers didn't go in and actually buy more ships, or, you know, had altered a pledge. So it's a really hard question to swing there.
It's harder because we don't have accurate numbers of like exactly how many pilots there are really and who has bought what, because we get the Star Citizens number, but I believe the Star Citizens number is actually the number of people that have like registered on RSI. Not all of those accounts have bought ships.
Right.
Yeah, so it's just
there are also ghost accounts. I'm already aware of several people that have multiple accounts, like three or four of them, just for the purpose of being able to hop swap a character and play the meta game.
Yeah.
So, speaking of just the game, the meta game in general. Oh, I completely lost that question. I shouldn't have spoken up. Anyway,
here we go.
Hero ships. Let's make a transition. All right, so hero ships. What do you think in the skin systems? Like, just the tailored loadout thoughts. You know, is it a concept? Are they a variant? You know, just in general, hero ships. What's your opinion, Erris?
I like it. Right now, you look at the hero ships, and they're all like inverse in lore created after, you know, this pilot that shot down the first Vanduul. But I can see this being in the future, once the game is live and running, I can see CIG saying something like, this pilot did something fantastic. We're going to make a ship off of Traz's Buccaneer that this is the loadout he had when he did this thing. Right?
You did that with this gun?
Yeah. And I can see them customizing loadouts to that and like having hero loadouts for actual players. And that to me is like, that's a cool idea, right?
Like that would just be, because they've talked about making your own legacy. And what better to have your own legacy than an Aurora MR with a single longsword on it, sold as a specialty ship because you took down a whole, like, a flight of super.
I don't want a legacy. I just want a Station 42 bobblehead, Mom. I have simple requests. Come on, make it happen.
Well, in your hero ship, there will be one of those on the dashboard.
Check.
I hope they can do that. I hope we get cockpit decorations. I don't know if you played MechWarrior Online. We will.
Supposedly, was a thing that...
It was in one of the funding goals, I believe. Cockpit decorations are a thing. They've actually already... Like, they've been trying to work out how cockpit decorations will work in, like, the ship getting hit and decelerating stuff. Will they fly all over? That doesn't really work. So they have talked about how cockpit decorations will work. I'm not an encyclopedia of StarCitizen.
I'm hoping that it's stupid, like stickers or something like that, because I would hate for like my hula dancer just to go vaped through to the.
Yep. Great. I think they'll have like.
Now I'm gonna kill this mother.
You know how in the hangar there are like specific hard points you can put your. I think it'll be the same in ship. Like you can have. This is a spot that your hula dancer will magnetize to the ship console and stays there, right? At least we have it, but...
Yeah. So say, like, a specific industry that makes these things, basically. They'd have to be specialty made. That's an interesting...
They already have that. That's the Takasu Miniatures group. They'll do that. And they'll make a little bitty figures or something, so that you can have your hero Buzz Lightyear right there with you.
Yep.
Tailored ship loadouts. Do you think that that's an advantage, disadvantage? I understand that. I like the reason that I heard the guy give about why they wanted to do that. They wanted to give more testing and vetting of certain mechanics because a lot of people just hop in and fly the ship. That's default. But what do you think about the tailor? Do you think that's a good touch, or is there a detraction point from it?
I can't think of one.
Neither can I.
I like it. Like, it's just, it makes sense. It's a good way for them to add more variety. And at this point, where we're still waiting on things like item system 2.0, and we're still waiting on the ability to do whatever we want with our ships, lots of people do just go in and play with the default because it's a pain to change the loadout. Well, now you've got different loadouts that are default, and I think lots of people will really like and take advantage of that. I know a lot of people are, you know, they're spending the extra $5-$10 and upgrading the ship that they already have to a variant that they prefer, right? Like, It's always good to have more options, I think.
So speaking of variants, CIG says that, you know, these hero ships are variants, or concept/variant, and has given them LTI. but they're being sold in, you know, very narrow windows, no week out price warning, or even a QA, you know, Q&A time, you know, like traditional variants, info or hard points. Just what do you think about that? What do you think about their new approach to this kind of variant or concept?
I hadn't even really considered that before, but I mean, I can understand why they're not going to do a Q&A for each one. Q&As are actually a lot of work. I mean, they do Q&As for the main ship. They're like, do they normally do Q&As for like, they're announcing the Vanguard. They don't do a Q&A for the Vanguard, Sentinel, Warden. They just do a Q&A for the Vanguard. So all these ships that they're announcing the variants for, I mean, most of them have already had the Q&As done in the past. So I don't see that the Q&A is a problem. They are offering the variants with LTI, which is what they've promised that they would do. They'd offer any new concept ship with LTI. The only problem is that they didn't give a week out warning, but I'm pretty okay with that as well, because they want to try and surprise us with some things. They didn't surprise us with the $400 Prowler because people have to be ready for that. But a few $10 like ship variants, I don't see a problem with that. Like let them keep some surprises for us, in my opinion.
Yeah. So you think that anything may have been handled, could have been handled better? Like, do you have any critiques at all? Really?
No.
Oh, cool. That's great.
I have a critique with the war bond stuff, but that's a different story.
The war bond stuff I still think is interesting, but at the same time, I do know why they're doing it, because, I mean, a dozen ships? I can only actually gift one of them, because all of those ships have been melted and turned into something else, and then melted and turned into something so many times, because I can't make up my mind on what I want, and no one can. And I think the idea of war bonds as a cheaper way, you get the ship for less, but you have to spend new money on it. I know a lot of people don't like it because it's a bit of a discount. I know a lot of things, but I like it. I think that it's something that, personally, to me, it doesn't bother me.
Yeah.
I know of a person that kind of got burnt biscuits over the fact that they devalued his money.
Oh, well.
And so he, like, basically had upgraded an 890 jump into something else, and then they made it, I don't know if they made it cheaper. I can't remember the exact details. Trasp.
Well, so the 890 jump actually is raised in value since it initially came out. The 890 jump was, I believe, and Erris, you may get me on this one, David, but 600, and now it's 9. I may be wrong on that one, but I do believe it's raised in value, and I think this particular instance, if you did trade it in, you'd actually, though it's $150 less for the ship, if that is the increase, then it's about $150, you know, still saved.
All I know is I bought a Starfare when it was first announced at like 170 or whatever it was. And then I melted it. And now, like 2 years later, it's jumped in size and jumped in price. I rebought it for $170 bucks. But my trade-in value, if I want to use it to trade in for something else, it's the current value. So I really don't think CIG are trying to screw people out of their money. They're trying to do things in a very, like, you paid for the ship when it was $170, but it's now worth $300. So if you want to trade it up and use it as credit, basically, it's still worth that $300. They're not going to make you only have the 170 that you originally did. They can't account for all variants because they've got, 1.5 million people that have signed up and bought different ships at different times and different things. I mean, you can't account for all variants. I don't think they're like trying to screw anyone over. but some people will be at some point. It's just, I mean, the number of I know it's happened before where like I bought a game on Steam and then the next like 2 days later it was on the weekend sale for half the price. You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's like, well,
damn.
So yeah, damn, but my bad.
Yeah, there's really nothing there's no heads up. You don't, and we don't expect them to give us a heads up. At least in a lot of these cases they do at with CIG. I agree with you. I happen to be in the same camp as you are, trying to take a people can be upset, and it's their complete right to be upset. They're part of the community. This is equally their product as it is ours. But, you know, it's they have to make the best decisions that they can moving forward. And yeah. I think legitimately this is one of those, you know, it was made by a group of people, and if the outcry is large enough, if they start losing funding because of it, because that is a form of protest the community can take, you know, then we can see that addressed. But I think it's a key note to point out that tell me another project that can happen in.
Yeah. I think it's also important to note that, like, yes, some people are arguing about it, but or you know, complaining about it. But at the end of the day, CIG takes our complaints pretty seriously. And the fact that they're not looking at this too, like, to stop it, the fact that they're continuing it tells me that it's the vocal minority that are complaining, and that, like, lots of people are taking advantage of it. And I think if more people are okay with it than not, mm-hmm. It's tough. It's always tough when dealing with money.
Yeah, a we'll see kind of thing is gonna have to happen.
Yeah.
So what do you think, Vaedrin? Contrasting view, I think.
Well, in all honesty, I think that there always needs to be a avenue. I think that the majority of the ships they're holding off as more rare, as more exclusive, those are the things that need to be cash driven. The war bond is okay in and of itself, but I would want a detraction of value to mirror that. So basically, like, if you're getting a standalone ship and you've got the war bond variant of a ship, maybe you get a lesser hangar, or maybe you don't get to have maybe it's a base model with no guns or something like that. I would want to have a lot more flexibility. I feel that I should have the option to buy, if I wanted to just buy an empty hull and be able to work that ship up into a working model, then I think that I should have a significant discount for it. A cash only discount, mind you. I think it could have been handled a little differently. So with that in mind, mirror for mirror, $10, $15, $20, $100, whatever the discounts that they want to give, I think it really honestly needs to have a detraction of value somewhere, some way, somehow. So I for one wouldn't mind having a heavily discounted Idris that I got to build. That would be pretty awesome. So
kind of like they did with
Javelin?
What they're doing with the bank, with the Javelin and the Bangle. Yeah. That would be very awesome in my opinion, because then I get to have an affordable version of the Idris that I can work on as a side project and still get to keep my LTI for the base hull. I mean, that's a beautiful thing to me. So
it's like a wholesale, if you will.
It's basically stripped down like version of
the base Retaliator.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, I've got a base Retaliator and I upgraded it to a Redeemer, but it's the same concept.
Yeah.
It's but maybe more stripped down. Maybe like there wouldn't be turrets or something like that. It would literally be a cash for clunkers kind of deal where I'm sitting here looking at a rust heap and I actually get to work at fixing it.
Ooh. Oh, so like a fixer upper.
Like quite literally, like this is what we found at Uncle Ben's salvage garage.
No power core, no cockpit, no. Right. You're talking bare metal.
Buy an Idris for $300 and have to supply everything on it.
See, that's my understanding of the Bangle.
That's the Bangle, and That's the javelin.
Javelin. It might also happen in game with things like the Idris. Like someone will find a floating Idris, an explorer will find a floating Idris, and they're not going to, like, they're a lone explorer. They don't have an org that they want, like, they don't care about it. They can sell the location to that Idris.
That's what I intend to do with the bangle, because there's supposedly like 5, maybe 10 roving derelict bangles floating around, and if we were having a nice heated little, well, shouldn't say heated, it was really just pirates being pirates, right? It was a discussion about what to do with a bangle should a pirate group find it, and my suggestion was really simple. Don't fix it up. Don't tell anybody that it's there. It is your floating derelict space station, just ready and ripe to make it a you only have a few rooms that are workable, and that way if somebody tries to take it from you, they not only do they have to fix it up, but they have to clean you out too.
That's actually a really good idea.
Why try to fix something, because the moment you fix it, somebody's going to have that much more reason to try and take it from you.
Yeah, but on the same token, what about having that mobile operation center that something like a bangle could give you, where you can project your power across multiple systems?
Not worried about power projection. You're not trying to project power across multiple systems. That's what the UEE is for.
Right. So hear me out. You're a couple jumps away, right? You're a couple jumps away. Your ships can leave the bangle, go attack the target, come back through those jumps, land inside of your bangle, and then you can jet.
No, I mean that's what other ships are for. I mean that's the premise. If I can fit 3 or 4 caterpillars on a bangle, why fly the bangle?
That would be nuts.
You know,
that would be insane.
So the idea is really simple. Don't use the bangle for the bangle, because everybody's going to want it. The moment that you build it, you got a giant target on your back. It's too big to hide. There's going to be people just looking. Think about this for a second. Think about the numbers. There is already 1 million+ people wanting and begging to play this game in some capacity. Now, granted, maybe 10% of those might be double accounts, alt accounts, those kind of things. But there are almost 1 million people wanting a bangle in some way, form, or fashion, to be a part of it, to just breathe the bacon-smelling air. I don't know. But my point is that the moment you build it, that to coin an old ass phrase, if you build it, they will come. I mean,
if you fix it, right? Drops,
if you fix it, they will come, and majority of them will be going after you. They'll to take it. It is the biggest. They don't want to break it. They want to stop you, stall you, kill you, and take your shit.
So
and. No bangle for me. No. I'll tell people where it's at just to start a war.
Hey, that's smart. Yeah, use it as the centerpiece. But, you know, speaking of these big ships, we've talked about the Javelin and Idris. We've talked about the bangle, but we haven't talked about the price bump. You know, it's a bit, just a teeny more expensive than it was previously. So, what are your thoughts on that one? We'll start with you, Erris.
I don't actually know how much of a bump it is. How much of a bump was it? I don't look at interest in the Javelin because I will never own one.
Hey, I read the script and I ask the questions. I don't know the information.
Like I'm sure.
Hold on, let me look.
good counter. Congratulations, sir.
I learned it from Erris earlier.
Our source of information, who's currently enjoying his food, which I wish I was, is saying that it was $2,500.
Yeah, the Javelin's like $200 more, I guess. $2,500. Yeah,
that's still a bump. That's a significant bump. That's a ship-sized bump.
We've known one of the first things CIG ever said, and something that they have been pretty thorough about the entire time, is that ship prices will go up. If you buy the earlier you buy it, the cheaper it is.
Mm-hmm.
With the exception of the 890 jump. Singe.
Well, I mean, that went up.
Oh, they lowered the price back down to 890. Is that
bingo.
What you're... Yeah.
Yep.
So they lowered the price from 900 to $890. So I'm assuming somewhere someone paid $900, or a few people paid $900 for an $890 jump.
Man behind the curtain.
They need a free hoodie. I think we should call on CIG to set.
He needs to have a free environmental coat attributed to his account so that he can at least look good so he can check off the
cold. Keep in mind, and this is a bit of history, they have actually done exactly that before. Now, I can't unfortunately remember exactly which ship it was, but there was a ship that had like a $5 difference. I know the Cutlass, for example, there was the Cutlass Pirate Edition that they eventually caved in and gave people money, like credit back, because of something. So like they have made that kind of thing happen before and have tried to make amends before. So
they made an error with the Avenger, with the Warlock, and it was to the tune of like a $30 error. And I was one of those people that I got lucky, because as soon as I seen the error, I actually sold my ship and then rebought and reclaimed my money, because I seen that it was 115, then all of a sudden it was like 85. And so I seen that the price had dropped significantly. So I just sent him a ticket and I said, hey, something's up with your prices, just letting you guys know. And then I went, sold it and bought it for the 85. Well, they wrote a script, and anybody that had bought a ship that bought a Warlock at the particular time that I made my original purchase was actually redeemed $30. And I actually went in and said, hey, you guys gave me $30. It's like, oh yeah, we know about it, but thank you for being honest about it. It's like, yeah. Okay.
Yep.
Money. Ooh.
So just got a good question from chat here. Do you think anyone is going to pick up gladiators to fill their Idrises, fill them up, or it actually says fill their Idrises tummies over super hornets or sabers?
Yes.
Yes.
I mean, you can have a little bit of both, but I personally think that the Gladiator is one of the nicest ships in the verse. That thing is an absolute pleasure to fly.
Oh yeah.
And it's got about 14 million missiles, and I like missiles. So yeah. People don't give the Gladiator enough love, in my opinion.
See, I actually heard someone yesterday. I was talking with someone who was actually dissing the Gladiator. So what would you say to a Gladiator hater? Just that rhymed, actually. I'm going to
point it did. That.
The Gladiator is great in more ways than one. It was one of the first... It was announced shortly after the Kickstarter. It was concepted shortly after the Kickstarter. It's one of the few ships that basically has not changed at all since the beginning. They did something really, really right with the Gladiator. It's more maneuverable than something like a Freelancer Miss. There's just something about it that I feel is better than a Super Hornet. I've always hated the Super Hornet, but I love the Gladiator, and it just, to me, it's a great, great little combat ship that just, it's the underdog. People don't consider it enough, and I like that.
And it just comes out of nowhere and just wrecks face.
Yeah.
Missiles.
I like missiles and torpedoes.
Yeah. So what do you think, Vaedrin? Oh, sorry. I didn't notice he was on the phone. I'm going to move on to something that I think is really cool, and it's on here. So, there's one more question. Is the new cash drive strategy impacting how ships are being sold? Do you think that's affecting the actual, amount of ships being sold? Do you think we might actually have more if that wasn't implemented? Or do you think we have more because it is implemented? Just kind of, your thoughts?
I think we have more.
Yeah, it looks like more. I mean, better year of funding, right?
Yeah, I'd say more. I mean, people still want the ships, and I mean, there's a lot of people that have been backers of the game forever and see something like that and are like, but there's a lot more people that are new. I mean,
true. Yeah. Yeah.
There's a lot more people that are new, and they don't have this you know, hatred of new money going into the game, because all of their money going into the game is new. So,
yeah. So what I was excited about before I caught the other question in the script, the Prowler concept. Very, very pretty dropship that we can shoot out of. And anyway,
yes.
So your favorite aspects of the Prowler concept, what are your first impressions? What just stuck out to you the most? Okay, Vaedrin, you got this one first. Erris, we got you second this time.
I love it. I love it for one really good reason. There are 17 kills on each one of them.
So your goal, you're saying that this is probably going to be easy to kill. What is that? What you're trying to say? It seems to me like this is going to be.
I think that if I had a redeemer going against that ship, I think that it would have to be able to sneak past me because it would be hosed, and I think that a Vanguard would be a significant threat to it.
So what do you think, Erris?
I think it depends on the situation. If you're trying to land on planet, I think that the Prowler will actually do much better in atmosphere and close to ground. I think it will also do better close to ships. They've talked about how it, like close to ground, it actually handles more like a land vehicle than a ship. I think it's a lot better for dropping. I've always actually hated the Redeemer because of the way it like pops down like a little ramp and everyone just runs off and they're completely open to fire. I like that the Prowler kind of protects its the people in it. I think that they're going to be used in different situations. I mean, yeah, like the Redeemer is much more for going into like a heavy gunfight and taking out other ships on the way in. The Prowler is more like you've got, you know, five Prowlers loaded up and a bunch of stealth Hornets, and you're going in there and you're going to hit them by surprise, right?
I got some Marines in there for you. It's a sneaky damn, it's a black van. It's what it is. That's why I was doing the Herbert. It's a black van flying around.
Yeah. Honestly, when I first saw it, though, the thing that surprised me the most was actually how alien it looked. Like, it does not look like a human ship. Like that. And that's really important to me. I mean, CIG are clearly treating each of the alien races as completely distinct from, you know, human ships. Like, you can tell that thing's an alien ship. It's just, it's menacing and like a praying mantis eagle thing that just.
It's why I still have my scout.
Yeah,
but that's actually part of the lore. The Codex, their warrior religion, meant that they had to be the most terrifying thing around. So their technology wasn't really great, except for in one area, and that was the grav plates and their shield tech. And so they made full use of that. I really do like the fact that they've made the front of it non-transparent, because then you really don't know if there's somebody in it or not.
Yeah.
It could be parked, and you could just be sitting there, you know, I don't know, having a smoke, watching whoever the asshole is in front of you talk about, hey, let's steal a ship. No, I don't want to steal a ship. No, I don't want to do it. And you're just like lining up your sights, kind of like, come here, hold still. Gotcha! Sorry, get excited.
It's right to get excited about it. And I like where they've taken, in the lore, they've taken this ship from. Like, you look at the Tavaren, and even the images that we just saw of the Tavaren, they're very, very warrior-like. Like, they evoke a lot of feudal, Middle Ages, like the armor, the pauldrons, and the staff, and the kind of skirt that kind of screams like chain mesh, like either Korean or European, like heavy armor. And it to me, the Tavarin, the entire design of both the Tavarin and the Prowler just screams like they want to get in there hand to hand and beat on things. And I think it's a really cool. I like it.
Oh, yeah.
Did you notice near the, I was paying really close attention to the neck, and what I thought I seen was like a chain coif, what it appeared to be. If you look in that section right there, it looks almost like he's wearing a chain laced helmet is what I see when I look at that picture. And I'm just like thinking to myself, man, these guys are really kind of geared for combat. I mean, I almost would wish that they were still a race in full capacity, because what would they versus the Vandal do? Hey, that'd be a fun thing to watch.
Who's to say that there isn't some kind of Tavarin resurgence that happens at some
point? They tried that. They actually tried that in 2601, I believe. It was a 7-year war. That's the second Tavarin war, and kind of got their asses stomped.
But there's another thing that they found. And this was like a planet. Let's see. Funny stuff there.
Erris, you all right?
I think that we lost.
Don't judge me.
We're not judging you.
Proud of
there is actually a
proud.
Proud warrior race.
Like that. No, he just that came out of his head. He didn't look that up. He didn't look up at the screen. He didn't Google nothing. No. He was like, okay, no. So see what happened was there was a 7-year war. That is almost that almost cost me. That's awesome. Like that's impressive. This is why he's a time
about it. I'm about as big an egghead as he is in some capacities, and I've read a piece of lore that they have found an empty planet. And this empty planet had derelict, staged, ready to go to Tavarin warships.
It's just, actually where they got the Prowler from.
Is that it? I don't know. I don't know if that was a fresh batch or if that was.
As far as I know, the Prowler came from this lost Tavarin world that there's no one on the world, but it was set up with all kinds of old Tavarin technology. Now, the Prowler is actually based on, it's not a new ship. This is actually from the first Tavarin War. And the first Tavarin War was, I believe, in 2541 or 2542. So the first Tavarin War happened a long time ago. I think they actually had first contact with the Tavarin in 2541, and then the first war started 2542, and it lasted for 6 years.
Well, that's the thing about it. I just was wondering. I swore that I had seen that somebody else was putting out old Tavarin pieces and trying to. When I read it, I took it to mean that there was like a possible resurgence, that there was a shadow group that. And see, the reason why I thought that was because it would tie in really well with why we have a new senator in the UEE that's a Tavarin.
The senator that's a Tavarin is the senator of the old Tavarin homeworld, which I think is now called Jalan, used to be called, can't remember. And before that was something with the K. Anyway, something with the K, yeah, Kalira or something. He's a senator because he was actually a really really highly decorated UEE veteran. He's one of only about 30 Tavarin that have actually been made citizens. No other Tavarin are citizens. So he's like the top of Tavarin. But I think he's going to be arguing more for Tavarin rights. And I think we might start to see some Tavarin rights stuff come out, because the Tavarin have been treated incredibly badly by the UEE. But I don't think... personally don't think we're going to see another resurgence of Tavarin, because they've tried that twice. And keep in mind, actually, after the second Tavarin War, the Tavarin went through something called the Purge, where a whole bunch of them followed their
codex.
Yeah, they basically killed themselves, because they had lost so badly they committed mass suicide. So
like a seppuku kind of thing.
Yes.
I'm getting bad looks now.
Uh-oh. Adjust the bow tie, quick. No. Perfect.
We're taking pictures.
Okay, so we're gonna try and get back on the, you know, the main subject.
Cash
here.
Incentive.
Yes. What?
You said main subject. Let's go.
No, price is an exotic ship.
Well, fine, if you insist.
But yeah, order script. Blowing my mind. Anyway, so price is an exotic alien ship. You know, we've already kind of talked about it. There's been some grumbles about the price, but it's been accepted that, you know, it's a rare ship. And, you know, kind of comes with a cost because it's alien. So what do you think that by the end of this sale, its performance is going to be like? You think it's going to be one of the hot shots of the sale? Or you think it's going to maintain being the top of the sale throughout? That's the big question.
If they put the merchantman back up, then no. But people really, really want the merchantman. There is such a love for the merchantman. It almost rivals things like the Carrick. I think that the Prowler is doing really, really well. I think the problem here is that it's an Asperia ship. And the thing that everyone seems to forget is all Asperia ships have been priced significantly higher than their loadouts would suggest. It's because they are essentially imports. It's like if you want to import a Japanese-only car to North America, you're going to be paying a premium on it. These are alien ships. They're. I mean, yes, Asperia is a human manufacturer or whatever, but the ships are still alien. They demand a premium is why it's so much more expensive. And I know that the price of it makes some people disappointed, but I think it's right for them to do. They've always said that there's a number of different facts. CIG have always said there's a number of different factors that determine the price of a ship, such as its loadout, what they want it to do in verse, the number of them they want in verse, and just the lore about the ship. And I have no qualms with its price.
Yeah. Vaedrin, any input?
Nah. I'm kind of done on buying ships, so I have no input on that one.
I can sympathize. Though I don't have a completionist, but you know, I think I'm set. My little org in my little, you know, realm.
All by myself.
Anyway. I've got like 12 people in my org. Thank you, God. Anyway, moving on from the depressing subjects.
So, who's in your org, baby? Just you and me.
What?
It's like, what was that? Penny Arcade? I remember that. That was a good show. Anyway. Okay. So what do we think about the new cache? Okay, so I think we've covered that one. Damn it. I think you skipped. Okay, so this is what happens to me when I try to read scripts. This is why I don't obey scripts.
What's a script?
What?
Huh? What? What?
We're scripted?
Where? Anyway.
Guys, we're scripted. Hold on.
What?
Huh? Oh,
damn it.
Sorry.
Okay, so damn it, Angela, where are we at?
So, what do we think of the new cash incentive marketing strategy, just in general? You know, we've kind of talked about it in specifics, but just as a general moving forward, I mean, David, you seem pretty well set on this, pretty, you know, pretty outspoken. This is a great idea, you know, is what I'm getting from you. But, you know, just any final thoughts before we move past the subject and you know, what it means, you know, for a subscriber or a concierge mending, you know, a member, just trying to get this all out in one go. Like,
in my opinion, it's important for people to remember that you're not, like, everything we're doing, all the money we're putting into this, it's not, in the end of the day, it's not supposed to be for the shiny ships. It's supposed to be helping CIG to make the game, and quite frankly, new money helps them more than melted money to make the game. Melted money isn't more money in their pocket, it's just your money that they already have moving around. I understand why they want to get new money in, and I understand why they're giving incentives to get new money in. And you know what? It's not like they're saying you can't buy it with credit. you still can, but we are all supposed to be here wanting the best game we can get. I don't think we should be, taking them to task for trying to get the money to do that.
So my weigh in on this is basically, I made a really good post on this. I actually did. It was a really, really, really good thing. The way that it worded was that everybody that's an artist in any capacity wants to actually see the promotion of their art, and I feel that game design is the same thing. I feel that game design is an art in and of itself. So with that in mind, I'm always thinking that these guys, I'm hoping that, I mean, of course, there's no way I could possibly ever know, but how many of these people probably reduced their rate on their typical salary just because they wanted to see their magnum opus created? That's what I'm thinking. Everybody that they probably pushed the boundaries of what they're living in to try and see this game made. So everybody that's ever wanted to try it, everybody that's ever wanted to do it is probably in on the bandwagon on this one. They want to be history makers, but at the same time, they can't live off of love. So they have to have fresh revenue. They have to have fresh income. There has to be something that they can still, they have families. They have car payments. They have house payments. They have bills. They have things that they have to do. I mean, you know, Chris is a millionaire, but not every one of them is. And most of them are probably living paycheck to paycheck, just like the rest of us slobs. So for us to sit there and get up in arms just because somebody is giving a $10 discount, I think in certain odd cases, maybe it's justifiable that person be mad, Traz. But beyond that, he's the only person that I know. He's the only person that I know that got burned from the deal. And I am all about trying to give more reasons for more people to play the game, to buy the game, to get into the game. And so I don't care if they sell Auroras for $5 a pop, but like I said, I hope they strip them down to nothing but the plates. But beyond that, you know, make more money. Make more money. Make it real.
I do think that just to chime in here, Traz was affected. You know, we've talked to him, but anyone that bought the completionist is affected. Now, that's 50 people initially. It's not a lot of people. We do, you know, but to keep in mind that these are people that, you know, this is crossing in that really gray area of special snowflakes, but these are people that have invested heavily in the game, and they feel, and maybe justifiably so, that what they've put into it should be at least maintained throughout and shouldn't be depreciated. Now, that's kind of what I'm getting as a feeling from that group. Now, I personally, I'm at a point because of how I'm invested, because of how I'm in the game. It doesn't affect me to that
I'm invested to the tune of about 2,500 myself. I think everybody in this little clicker right here has gotten at least over $1,000 worth for a video game. He's crying over here. But that's you see my point.
I know I'm not, you know, one of the larger backers, but I also don't make a lot of money. I've put 4 into ships, and I've put about another 9 into various websites, maybe actually starting a new one. Now we're up to about 12 into various websites. So, no, I mean, I'm not even getting ships out of the websites. I'm doing this because I want CIG and I want Star Citizen to be as good as it can be. And I mean, for the completionist stuff, I'm pretty sure, like, even at the beginning, it wasn't much of a discount to get the completionist. It was more about supporting the project, and in my mind, that's what it should be about. It should be about supporting the project. And if I mean, actually, the Endeavor, I bought the complete Endeavor, right? The $900 everything included in the Endeavor. Yeah. And then I realized, you know what, this is stupid. All I want is the hope. But there was no way for me to go back and just get the... What I had to do was I had to melt my complete one. And then for some reason, like, because I still wanted LTI on it, I couldn't... I had to, like, upgrade an Andromeda. But anyway, at the end of the day, I lost $150 on that melting and rebuying and stuff because of the way it worked. I lost $150, but I mean, so what? CIG still get the money. It still goes towards the game, and I don't care.
Well, Traz is wanting to make a point here. This affects every backer who has backed prior, before the war bonds ever made. Like I said, the reason why I mentioned it that my meager, according to Erris, investments is because, you know, how many of those ships could I have saved a lot of money on? This affects everybody, and so I could see why people would be upset. At the same time, I also see the need. So I'm very, to me, it didn't do nothing to me. So like, I want them to have the money. That's the reason why I'm a subscriber. I want them to have more money. So please keep going. Just whatever it is, keep the lights on.
Yeah, it's hard to say at the end of the day. It's like it's up to each individual person on what they. I mean,
certainly.
Yeah. What they feel is justifiable. And that is going to be a hot button topic from here on until every time.
we are all victims of a phenomenon known as groupthink. And so it's very easy. If your buddy is upset about something, you're upset that your buddy is upset. And so intrinsically you become upset. And then you explain to people, hey, my friend is really upset over here because of this thing happened to him. Oh, really? Well, that kind of sucks, man. And then all of a sudden, groupthink. So it's very easy for people to take this thing that a few brazen, spoken few just pop up and say, hey, you know, this doesn't feel right. You know, 20 people start saying that, then all of a sudden there's this mob of smombies, smartphone zombies that are just like, what the hell? That doesn't sound right. I'm gonna call Bruce Chandler and damn it, we're gonna talk about this shit. And there it goes. Here we go. We got to pick on Bruce too. Let's go ahead and skip forward here.
there's one more thing about this whole thing that I would like to ask, and this is just because this kind of clarifies what we're talking about affecting everyone. The Super Hornet. This is the probably the last thing I want to touch on, the cash incentive. It was offered cheaper than any opportunity to the backers previous. Yep. So, you know, in this instance, in that instance, all of us, you know, from those who backed in 2012 to those who backed just a few months ago, obviously it wasn't available a few months ago, but the last time it was available, which, I don't remember off the top of my head, to be honest. But, what do you think? Do you think there should be any compensation, or do you think, because, you know, my opinion also is it's worth the change. It's worth to bring in the new people. I already paid it. It doesn't really matter. I don't want to be compensated. But do you think that the outcry of being compensated, you know, of wanting compensation is justifiable?
This is one that I think they did too early. I think what we're going to start seeing happen, and I think this is something we're going to start seeing happening in the verse and even before the verse with things like the Super Hornet, is CIG have actually said numerous times that there are going to be multiple editions of these ships. Like there's a 2942 Aurora, 2943 Aurora, 2944, and as new ones come out, as a new Super Hornet variant is shown off and announced, then yeah, maybe the old one goes less expensive. Now I'm kind of disappointed that they did this while they're still in crowdfunding. This is the one that I'm like, you guys, okay. You said really early on in the campaign that when you're buying it now, that's the cheapest it's going to be. I kind of wish they had kept that. And this Super Hornet one kind of breaks that, which is slightly disappointing, but at the same time, I'm not a Super Hornet owner, so it doesn't affect me too much. At the same time, if they did it for something like the Freelancer, which was my first ship, I still wouldn't care because I love the amount of money I think I've gotten my money's worth out of my Freelancer already, and I've basically flown it twice. So,
yeah, yeah.
I have a problem in that I have a ridiculously positive and optimistic outlook on almost everything Star Citizen. So,
Canadian?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Oh. Oh man.
Sorry.
You okay? Yeah. I'm sorry. But
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry that you guys are sorry. As long as every time there's a new ship that there is a very extremely marginal benefit to buying it, and that like the real world, they're always going to make slight, very subtle improvements in games, in cars and car manufacturers. As long as that's one of the things that also justifies the maintaining of the high price and the other ships getting the cheaper price, then I'm fine with it. So that's also food for thought. The ship that was made, this Super Hornet, this iteration of it, should feel like a noticeably different version of a Super Hornet compared to the one 10 years in the future. It should feel, you can tell the difference in an old Mustang and a new Mustang. And I'm just using a car as a reference. So I'm hoping that they stick true to that too. I'm hoping that, you know, maybe it's got some tweaks in the armor, but maybe this one has a faulty thruster. Maybe this one actually fixed all the thruster problems, but all of a sudden the shield generator, you had to go in and like solder in the... I'm hoping that they have some really interesting bugs to fix too.
Oh, yeah, I can't wait for the engineering mechanic, but all right. So we've nailed down the anniversary sale, the cash incentive. I think we've covered all that, and we can move on here to the fun part. So that wraps
also,
up
the that's what's Canadian. So yeah, we've nailed that down pretty well.
So anyway, that wraps up what's new in Star Citizen portion of the show, and slightly controversial today. It was a good conversation. But let's go on with the party and see what our guest has to say about his story. So, Erris, tell us your story. What got you into Star Citizen? What was your spark?
My spark? Freelancer. I had played Freelancer. I really enjoyed it. I heard, hey, the guy that, you know, made Freelancer is making another game, and he's running a Kickstarter. And I was like, sign me up. Done. Then I forgot about it for 2 years. Then I wrote a short story, got me into this weird little news org, and now I'm here.
Fun times, because that's very similar in some ways to my story. I was playing Freelancer, and I enjoyed it that much, and I didn't. Like I said, I'm a prolific Wikipedia nerd. And so I looked up Freelancer because I wanted to know more about the game. And so I found out who had made the game. Chris Roberts didn't ring any bells to me. It was like, okay, it's a name in Wikipedia. And then I found out that the person that made Freelancer is making this game. And oh, by the way, he was a movie director too. I'm like,
Interesting.
Credentials.
Yeah, there's a reason my first ship was a Freelancer.
Yeah. Was it because it's a mini Serenity?
No, it was actually because it was named the Freelancer. I originally couldn't decide between Super Hornet Freelancer or something else. Can't remember what. But I was like, you know what? I liked Freelancer. I'm going with the Freelancer. And that was my decision.
Yeah. So
the original modeling does look very in taste to what Freelancer that game was about.
Now there's something that I don't know if you know about, but if I can find it. Sorry. They actually had two different mock-ups for the Freelancer. Now one of them won, but there's this one. I'm going to post this in Skype, and one of you can post it in the Twitch chat, because I have different
things. We've got Zool behind the scenes, so Zool will take care of it.
This was the Freelancer that I wanted. This model.
Oh. I didn't see that.
Now, way, way, way back. way back, there was a vote where the community was given the option to vote on this one or the one that we eventually got. I voted for this one. This is the freelancer I wanted, and it looks nothing like the Serenity, and I think it's glorious.
It does.
Like it that is. Is. I mean, it does. That is a glorious ship.
Makes me think of my 747 Vanguard with a little bitty dude sitting like this tall right beside it. Man, I wish I had that one instead.
doesn't this look like a cool ship? Oh,
yes, it does.
Anyway, sorry.
It looks kind of similar, though, in design to the F8 Lightning. I wonder if the same artist did it, because it's got that out there kind of steep curves, really, really sharp angles. I can kind of see it.
Yeah, if I rotate a little bit. And
I liked that one.
Real quick.
Yeah, I figured you were going to do that. See,
and this was the other option we were given. But anyway, I wanted that. I wanted option two.
Well,
for anyone wondering what I'm talking about, if you Google Star Citizen Freelancer original options in the images, it's like the first two images.
Oh, that's awesome. Hey, at least we show up early on Google search results. So, Vage, you want the next one?
You would ask me that as soon as I took a bite of food.
See, I like throwing you under the bus, and I like throwing the people behind the scenes under the bus. It's fun to throw people under the bus, but I know it gets reciprocated, so I'll wait for it.
Oh, I know. Traz has got an apron stink waiting on you. All right, so I'm going to go off your cursor and say that this is where we are.
No. What? No. One above.
You better learn to move that cursor, bub.
I don't know
how to. Little behind the scenes tidbits, right?
Guys, we're really well organized. We're professionals.
We are professional in the capacity that we keep on going. That's the name of the game.
Dave, what kinds of games do you?
Well, Dave can be a professional. We want to be blue collar. We're the rednecks. Well, I'm the redneck and Traz is the professional. There we go. We got this right. what kind of games do you favor the most? Strategy games, first person shooters. Well, what's your go-to sit down on the couch and play?
FPS.
Nice.
FPS all the way. Right now, I'm having a lot of fun with Overwatch. Still, so I like Overwatch.
Did you just because anyone that says FPS, I have to ask. PlanetSide 2.
Did not like it.
Really?
Didn't enjoy it. I found the handling was garbage.
Okay, that's fair.
That's
100% ag. Yeah,
we're talking FPS here. To me, an FPS has to be responsive, and PlanetSide 2 is not what I would term responsive. Which is why I'm really hopeful about Star Marine. I thought that it looked good, and I'm hoping that that's the kind of responsiveness we'll get in Star Citizen. Because PlanetSide 2, it had the giant things, but like you'd group with like four people, but then you couldn't do anything, and you'd spend most of your time running across empty land. Anyway, sorry, I'm just.
Would it be a deal breaker if it doesn't live up to your expectations?
What, Star Marine?
If it does, if that was like the one thing that they just couldn't tweak right, would that be a game changer for you?
It would be disappointing. But it would not be a deal breaker for me, because honestly, I backed before there was even supposed to be an MMO portion of the game. I backed when this was, you know, this was a single player game only, and they might add, you know, an MMO, and there was no mention of FPS.
I backed FPS before it was cool.
I backed October 2012, so.
I backed before it was cool. That's kind of what I got from that. It's just that you're thinking like. Because I
am a hipster. Look at me. I'm wearing a bow tie.
Time Lord.
Well, I'm a.
There's a fez back there.
I'm
the fez. Thing.
Yeah, I got a hat on. Come on, man. Wear the fez.
Fez.
Fez is so far away.
Okay.
He is totally not one with the fez.
Okay. So, have any close friends or family that you play SE with? Or what about your significant other? You know, do they play SE with you, or is it just...
She's playing Minecraft right now. No, I honestly don't even play Star Citizen right now. I with all the news that I do, I don't really have time. I'm going to start getting into it more when 2.6 is out, because I really want to try Star Marine. I'm really looking forward to 3.0, because I've got a number of friends that are waiting for there to be a bit more universe stuff to do. I've got a pretty decent group of people that want to play, but we're all kind of just waiting for there to be more of a game, because we don't want to burn out when there's not much of a game yet.
Yeah, right. Yeah, fair. Great. That you've got great answers. I'm going to point out your answers are like there's really hard to follow up on because they're so complete and well. Anyway,
sorry.
That's the thing about it, though. And I'm not trying to knock any of our previous guests, but sometimes when we would have a guest on, if a person was interrupted, they would be really, really be like, "How dare you interrupt me?" And I'd be like, "I'm sorry. Shit.
Oh, God. Shit."
But this is supposed to be an energetic conversation, so interruptions are just part of the deal. And so some people walk into it, I think they don't really realize it. This is intended to be a conversation. This is intended to be, let us ask you 20 questions. Yes, that's exciting. Next week on Station 42.
I'm down for that.
It is difficult to do, like, natural feeling conversation on Skype, yes, because you don't get the you know, the audio and the, like, or the visual cues and lots. But, I mean, yeah, it's, I think all of this should be about the conversation. It's, let's talk Star Citizen.
Yeah.
Talk Star Citizen, you know?
So
all day.
Let me turn off my alarm here, because I'm a big nerd like that. But what kind of gaming style do you see yourself going for the long haul? Do you want to be the FPS guy, guru, gung-ho, constantly dropping out of ships and just saying, "Here, grenades for me to you.
With
have
the
them."
Camera.
Or yeah, with a camera too. I could see that. I could totally. He's gonna make a camera grenade so he could sit there and see the look on the guys' faces before they detonate. Huh? What? That would totally.
The only
awesome.
Way to
do
get
that
shot. It's the only way to get that shot.
I can see myself doing a lot of different things.
Sorry, I gotta spit this out of my head before I lose it.
Go for
Erris.
It.
Erris, coming at you live, straight from this Vandal kingship, where I'm going to get a close in-person interview with this Vandal. Chunk?
Vandal. Boom. Friend or frenemy? We find out tonight at 10.
What's bacon really made of? There you go.
What? Wait, what's bacon really made of?
That is an Operation Pitchfork line, if I've ever heard one. That is, that's truly Pitchfork kind of guys.
How many grenades can I shove down this Vandal's throat at a time?
Find out next time on the next episode of The Shipster.
Yes.
Wow. Yeah. There you go.
Hey,
maybe
there's a bit idea for you. Shipster.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
The test report. What happens when you crash an Aurora into the front of a Bengal? We find out tonight at 9.
Dude, you know what? Once permadeath.
Later on, after 6 Central SET for the weather. Because Earth's weather is still going to be the predominant weather that everybody else cares about. It's like cold as shit over here, but at least they have a nice sunny day. Fuck y'all. I could totally see that happening.
And Terrans are like, "Hey, no, our weather's really nice too." Shut up, Terra. Okay.
Yeah, really. Get back down. Where the hell did you come from? Hey.
So any favorite game mechanics from other games that you wish you could see in Star Citizen? You went full horizontal on this one.
God, that is a difficult question.
I've got one. So this
ain't
might
about
sound... I know. So okay, what do you got? Because this is just one of those things that I have a weird desire for.
What's that?
That's like that kind of show.
Oops. No. So RTS games. You know, just having that objective view. I really want, if you ever played Supreme Commander, that tactical screen. Scroll out all the way, and you can see every unit on the map. every building, every structure, everything that's in one place. I want that view. Moreover, I want to be able to click the things in that view.
Command center, bangle carrier done. Yep.
I know exactly, but I want to see it. I want to do it, and it's technically kind of from another game where I got like where I want it from. That's the only. So hopefully that's inspiration for you, David.
I don't know what I want from another game. I know what I don't want. I don't want the way of healing that has been done basically always in games. I've always found
Zapper's like, ray on you.
Or Battlefield 1, here, let me hit you with a syringe and you've come back to life.
It was meth.
Yeah. I don't care if it's meth. You got hit by a grenade in the face. A tank literally walked up to you, looked at you in the face, and shot you in the head with like a thing. This I don't care if you're given pure freaking.
This is going to be the first show that we make a Canadian cuss on. Congratulations.
No, I want. And CIG have promised this the entire time. It's one of the reasons I'm really looking forward to everything they do. I want more detail in medic stuff. I want medic to not just be here, throw a bag and use some paddles to bring someone back. I want the medic to have to go in there in the fight, grab someone, drag them away, splint a leg, like do something to keep the person alive, you know?
Staple
gun. It's well, even I don't know. I don't know what I want. I just want something more than we've had. Because no game has done it right, in my opinion.
I am 100% behind you on that one, man. With the Cutlass Red, with what they're talking about with Risky. Oh, I'm going to talk about that for days. Vaedrin, stop me.
I know. Okay, I'll stop you. I know what I would like to see in game, even though I've never really said it. Low orbital drop pods. I don't even want to have to land. I want a Bangle or a larger capital ship to be able to shoot the marine nails. It actually is in lore. Marines actually drop out of pods known as nails. I want to actually have some player-controlled functionality of that. I would want to be able to drop marines from space onto the planet.
I would like to chime in on this, and I would like to drop Marines from another ship onto another ship.
It should be possible. Well, think about it like this. Let's assume that like the it's like a torpedo. So like you stuff like 10 bodies into a torpedo, launch the thing, it like sticks onto the ship, and then they all break out. That would be acceptable to me.
Go. Oh, yeah.
Hey, person.
Oh man. All right, I'm going to daydream about that. So any gripes with Star Citizen so far, and you know, resolved or outstanding?
Hashtag mobile first.
Damn.
Spectrum.
All set.
Spectrum looks amazing. I'm really looking forward to Spectrum, but if it doesn't come out on mobile, either at launch or very soon after launch, it's not going to catch on, not going to be worth it. No one's going to move over to it from Discord because Discord is pretty much ubiquitous at this point. And the reason Discord came so fast and became ubiquitous so fast is that it launched with mobile support. Spectrum has to launch with mobile support. So far, we haven't heard of anything about that. Turbulent had it at the very end of their list at the CitizenCon presentation. It cannot launch last.
Well, Battle.net sucks and people still use it, so
only because we're forced to. No one's going to use
Spectrum. We go.
But Spectrum, you're not forced to use Spectrum, right? Like, why would I use Spectrum for in-game voice chat? Like, why would I migrate my org over to Spectrum?
To get new people.
But if I can't keep up with them on my phone. I can't keep up with them at work because RSI is blocked at work. I need it on my phone if I'm going to run an org.
Yeah, and furthermore, I mean, they do seem to try and incentivize it a little bit by saying, hey, we've got in-game, you know, acoustics, so if you're within a certain distance of someone, the audio would change. So that's awesome and everything, but I agree with you 100%. If they don't do mobile, if they don't give support for Android and iOS, it's not going to be what they want it to, and that's sad.
The local acoustics is a slight concern to me because I've had some wonderful planet side 2 experiences with people playing constantly over and over in a tank, just sitting there, just chilling out, playing music over and over and over and over. And I'm like, if you ever leave this circle, I am so going to team kill your ass. It's like I like a song every now and then. I'm a very open-minded musical person, but I really please to quit playing it so damn much. Come on, people. And there's going to be people that do that. So what you're basically telling me is that somebody somewhere is going to boombox like MC Hammer flying around in space, pirating people, shooting their shit up. Can't touch this. It's going to be like the thing on his ship as he flies by, and your like corpse is spinning around in space. Traz is dancing.
Yes, so everyone watching the podcast right now is not being graced by Traz's glorious dancing, but be assured, the beard and dancing is outstanding. So on to the final question. Vaedrin, you want
this
one?
The beard is making him dance, really.
The beard is the brain.
Pretty much. Yep. It's like, what's under Traz's, like, what's the Chuck Norris fist joke? What's under Chuck Norris's beard? Another fist? There you go.
I thought it was a double chin. Anyway, so
yeah, all this time, who would have thunk it? Where I found Jesus.
Under your beard? I'm not going to question that. So what are you looking for most of all? Next in line after all of the currently known or announced, features or ships?
I think we've pretty much beat him to death on what he's looking forward to.
But no, we haven't. We've only beaten him to a pulp. He's not quite dead yet.
Honestly, yeah, it starts with the Reclaimer and ends with the Endeavor. The Reclaimer was the first ship, the first concept ship that to me spoke of something that we hadn't seen in games before, period. Like, I mean, even the Starfare, having to refuel your ships, We've seen that in games, but the idea of another ship, a completely separate ship, going in after a battle and salvaging the remnants of that battle because that's profitable, and then taking like that just hasn't existed before, ever. The Reclaimer to me,
I loot dead corpses all the time.
But like, let's say you're playing World of Warcraft, you're running around looting the corpses, but the Reclaimer would come along after and then pick up those corpses and then turn those corpses into stew. I don't know. There's something about the Reclaimer that to me just spoke of something so much more that the game wants to do. They want to do something different. And then the Endeavor to me culminates that. You've got an entire ship that basically has absolutely no armaments whatsoever. It's there for science and medical stuff. Like, it's just, this is a science ship. And if you want to just put a giant radar on it and find new planets, and that's all you do, then that's all you do. And I love that idea. Just the freedom to do whatever you bloody want.
I thought about the farming thing and being able to actually grow crops on it. But that's the only thing that's ever really appealed to me about the Endeavor, just to be able to just sit there and rack in money. Like, I could be, like, making all kinds of skooma.
Space pot.
No, skooma. Yeah. We've got it figured out. And, this is a Chris Roberts game. There were cat people in his previous games. I'm pretty sure there's a cat person somewhere around in here in this one.
Probably. I hope so.
There you
cosplay.
Go.
Cosplay. I can't wait for the cat people cosplay.
Kilrathi, right? I think that's why
they went with like lizard people this time in the Van Duel, not cat people.
And turtles. Don't forget about turtles. We got turtles.
Yep. Toidles. I like toidles.
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 Toidles. Anyway.
Anyway. I think we're getting close to the end of the show. I'm not absolutely sure. I'm pretty sure that if not, then Basics is going to correct me so nicely.
No correction.
No correction? All right. So, ready for rapid fire? Just five quick questions?
No.
Not ready? Okay, here they come anyway.
Let's do it. Let's do it.
Flight control of choice.
HOTAS.
Favorite flyable ship and weapons loadout.
Gladiator Standard.
Most anticipated game mechanic.
procedural pick. Planets.
Favorite way to earn wreck?
Don't earn it.
Next ship you will buy or melt for?
Origin 600, maybe.
All right, folks, that about wraps it up. Any last questions or comments before we head out?
Thanks for having me on.
Any questions for us?
Just thanks for having me on. It was a good time.
Awesome. Very much. No, very, very nice.
And thank you for being on the show. I mean, this was fantastic. We've covered a lot of hot button topics. We covered a lot of new stuff that's come out. And I've been a part of a couple shows, nowhere near as many as Vager in here. But I got to say, this has been, both as a fan, as a member of this show, awesome.
Loved basics, it. Basics, Erris, this is our 1 year, this is our first episode in the second year of us being on air.
Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.
Awesome.
And thanks for being here again. Yeah. And Vaedrin, thanks for having me on. And Traz, thanks for being Zool behind the scenes. I'm going to talk with a lift.
I'm going to like chew on his tongue while he talks to everybody. All right. So, guys, I don't do this, but I'll do it. In addition to the wonderful guest hosting with us, I'd like to thank our listeners as well. We appreciate your time with Station 42 and look forward to any feedback you leave us. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Thank you, everyone. We will see you next week. Time to feed another hobo to the quantum drive. Would you like to say that?
I did. I really wanted to talk about the hobo. You can talk about it. I'm actually going to go feed the hobo real quick to the quantum drive and keep us afloat to see it later. God.
He's so sensitive. He's so sensitive. All right. Roll out.